healthy. Yep.
Could be. Oh, we don't know, really.
I didn't ask for the subject matter. Right. But that's
maybe
the next
we'll get
best
like,
question.
You know, 10 races. That'll be fun. Well, yeah, no, that's what it is. I just.
All right. I'm calling the meeting to order. Welcome, everyone. We'll do roll call.
Certainly. Mayor Brooke?
Here.
Commissioner Simmons?
Here.
Commissioner Carter?
Present.
City Manager Babinick?
Here.
Deputy Senior Attorney Dunkiel.
Here.
All right, very good. If everybody would please rise and join us in a moment of silence for whomever might be in your hearts. Thank you so much. We have an amazing young lady that's going to lead us in the pledge tonight, Carter Simmons. Come on up, Carter. And Carter is in VPK with Imagine Charter, and her dad is a good friend of mine. Ready, Carter? Okay, go ahead, Carter.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Fantastic! Fantastic!
Yeah.
Woo. Yeah. All right, your dad and I are coming down, and I got a present for you, Carter. And this is a t-shirt, and it says, I led the pledge.
Yeah.
All right.
All right, you're going to hold the shirt.
Okay. All right, got to hold this shirt.
And we're going to take a picture.
And you're going to be in the middle, okay? We're going to take one with us standing, and then we're going to go on our knees. And Carter, you look so pretty too. All right, we have a couple of legislative updates. With us tonight, we have our amazing representative, Dan Daly. Welcome, Dan. Carter wants to go up with you and be part of the presentation.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Carter and I are here tonight to brief you on the last legislative session. What you may not know is the last time Carter and I hung out, she was a little smaller, and we were having pancakes at the Coral Springs Diner. So I think we need a redo, Carter. If that's all right with you, we'll go back and make it happen again. Dad's not invited. Mr. Mayor, Vice Mayor, Commissioners, it is really good to be home with all of you. And I mean that in the literal sense of here physically in Coral Springs and not in Tallahassee. For those of you that don't know, your state legislature is considered part-time. And yet we spend about 6 months of the year in Tallahassee when you add up session, committee weeks, special sessions we've had so often they're no longer special, spend a lot of time there. And so it really is a great opportunity to come home and be in the community that I grew up in and be with all of you and be in a chamber that I had the good fortune to serve in, that seat right there, for so many years. And so I've been blessed to represent this city. It's hard to believe since 2012. And now to have the opportunity to do it in Tallahassee really means the world to me. So anytime I get to come back and speak with all of you, it's a great opportunity, Mr. Mayor. I did want to address one thing. My ID badge no longer works on the door. So I don't know who I see about that, Mr. Manager, but if we could take care of it, I'd really appreciate it. Mr. Mayor, we had a very good session, I'll be honest. Overall, and I mean kind of for our office specifically. I'll be honest, it wasn't a perfect session. There were still some bills that made it through the process that are challenging. Candidly, not as challenging of a session as we've seen the last couple years, and I'm glad for that. In the case of our office, I was fortunate to have 6 bills of mine passed by the state legislature, more than any other Democrat. Wow. In the process. 11 of our co-sponsored bills passed as well. Over $2.8 million secured in the 2024 state budget, which I'll get to a couple that I know Commissioner Simmons particularly is interested in just a second. But it really was. I learned at a very young age that Tallahassee, while we can have some very challenging conversations and very, in all candor, some bad pieces of legislation pass through, you can reach across the aisle, you can work with the other side, and you can do good work for the people of Florida when you're willing to take the party and sometimes the credit out of it, and I've been fortunate to do that. So if it's all right with you, Mr. Mayor, I wanted to touch on a couple of the measures that we're fortunate to get across this legislative session. Starting with House Bill 915, which relates to outpatient health services. For those of you that don't know, you heard me mention that the state legislature is a part-time gig, which means I have a full-time job on top of it, and I have the opportunity to serve in another capacity as an assistant state attorney in the Broward State Attorney's Office as a prosecutor. And it didn't take me but a few months as a brand new prosecutor to realize that our mental health criminal justice system is broken. And it's broken at all levels, the felony level, the misdemeanor level, and I saw it firsthand at the misdemeanor level, and that's the crux of what HB 915 aimed to fix. So to put it into perspective, when someone is charged with a misdemeanor offense, now keep in mind, these are the lowest level criminal offenses, trespass, battery, things like that, but they're still very important, and they're still crimes. When someone is charged with a misdemeanor offense and they are deemed incompetent to proceed, they've gone through an evaluation, they've been deemed incompetent to proceed, meaning they're not mentally well enough to proceed, most of those cases, I would say the overwhelming majority, just get dismissed. And that same person ends up back in the courtroom for a similar offense shortly thereafter. It's a revolving door. We don't provide them access to services. We don't fix the issue as far as the community is concerned. So as far as I'm concerned, it's a lose-lose situation. And part of that was because county court judges who are assigned to handle misdemeanor cases can't do anything. Their hands were tied. They basically said once a year had passed, a calendar year had passed since that person had been deemed incompetent to proceed, they had to dismiss the case. They weren't able to get that person access to services. And so House Bill 915, the language from House Bill 915 passed in a larger mental health package this legislative session. And what that does is permit county court judges to send someone to outpatient treatment so they don't have to wait. So it's not a revolving door. And we're not waiting for that individual to commit a more serious crime, because people who commit a felony, they can get access to services. Right, we treat that at a different level, and right now we're just waiting for that person to commit that felony, which is not good for that person, and it's not good for our community. So, Mr. Mayor, I'm proud to say that that bill passed the first year of its filing during this legislative session. A second one that I want to touch on is a little bit drier, maybe not as sexy unless you're a business owner or you have folks that are familiar with the workers' comp situation, the workers' comp system, House Bill 161. Workers' comp system, for those that aren't aware, it's the system that is supposed to provide access to care to employees who get hurt on the job in an effort to quickly and efficiently and safely get them back to work, right? It's a commitment that we as workers have made with our employers, saying if we get hurt on the job, we will forego our access to the courts in the traditional sense, right? A typical lawsuit. We will avail ourselves of the workers' comp system and in exchange, we should be provided access to care. What's happened, Mr. Mayor, is because the rates and reimbursements are so low that individuals and workers have not been able to find specialists, have not gotten adequate access to care. I've heard cases of individuals having to drive 2 and 3 hours from their home just to see a specialist in the workers' comp space. That's not how this is supposed to work. And so for the first time, In 25 years, the legislature acted on workers' comp and passed House Bill 161 with the help and support of Senator Jennifer Bradley from the Jacksonville area that increases the maximum amount of certain witness fees related to workers' compensation cases and increases the maximum reimbursement for physicians and surgical procedures under workers' comp so that we can provide that access to care that workers so rightly deserve.
That's good to hear.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And the last one that I'll touch on, actually two more if I may, just because I know the supervisor, Kurt's here, with Coral Springs Improvement District, fortunate to have sponsored House Bill 793 for the Coral Springs Improvement District. It was a local bill, sailed through the process with their support and their team's support, made some changes that I think were very necessary. And I just want to give a shout out to Coral Springs Improvement District. And I know you all have heard me, and if you've heard me up here before, I've probably mentioned the districts and some that I'm not as satisfied with as others. I will tell you the new board at Coral Springs Improvement District has been doing an excellent job and is out in the community and is talking to their residents and the people who elect them. So I'm very proud of the work that Kurt and his team are doing, and I hope that you'll continue. I know that you'll continue to do it. I was proud to sponsor 793 on their behalf. That's waiting for the governor's signature as well. And Mr. Mayor, the last one that I'll touch on is one that is near and dear to me, and I've filed it the last couple years. It's not technically a bill. It's what's called a House memorial. And what this means is this is legislation that we pass that sends a message to Congress to do something, to act or not to act, depending on the verbiage of the memorial. House Memorial 1145 relates to Florida's National Guard. I realized very quickly when I was on a tour of Camp Blanding, that's our National Guard main training base in Stark, Florida, that our National Guard is wholly understaffed. Candidly underfunded as well, but particularly understaffed, and it's for this reason. We don't set the number of National Guardsmen and women that we're allowed to have. The federal government does that. And so right now, the state of Florida is actually capped. We can't have more than 12,000 National Guardsmen. For a state of 23 million, read that through, we can't have more than 12,000. So state with a huge coastline, huge propensity for natural disasters, and yet we are capped at 12,000. Put it in perspective, if anybody's from Alabama, no offense to Alabama, the population of Alabama is 5 million. They are capped at the same 12,000 that we are here in the state of Florida. And what we have seen as a result of activations both here, both domestically and federally, because the National Guards, just as a reminder, can be activated by both the governor and the president. They were activated during COVID. They're activated for civil unrest. They're activated for hurricanes. We have Florida National Guardsmen in 6 out of the 6 combatant commands around the globe, and yet they're still the same 12,000 men and women. We are asking them to do it again and again and again. If you're familiar with the concept of the National Guard, these are supposed to be our citizen soldiers. They're supposed to be here. They're supposed to be called on in times of need, not recycled again and again and again. So they're getting burnt out. And you've had a lot of folks who are not re-upping the National Guard because it's been hard on them, it's been hard on their families, and candidly, who can blame them? So House Memorial 1145 urges Congress to increase that number so that we can get more good men and women into our Florida National Guard, relieve the pressure on our current guardsmen, and continue to do the job that they do for us day in and day out. Mr. Mayor, I did want to touch very briefly on some of that $2.8 million that we brought home, and I know it's of particular interest to Commissioner Simmons, and I look forward, fingers crossed, to being at the ribbon cutting for the City of Coral Springs Everglades Greenway Loop. Awesome. We're fortunate to get funded at the full amount of $800,000. Looking forward to that, looking forward to being there. I know that that's going to be a gem, not just for this community, but regionally for this entire Northwest Broward area. The governor's office is very key on regional, so that's why I'm making sure, not that anybody from the governor's office is watching, but I'm going to show them this clip. It's regional. It's regional in nature. Don't veto it. We need this money. And we'll put it to good work here in Coral Springs for the Everglades Greenway Loop. I did want to mention, Mr. Mayor, just a couple of things that the topics that deserved more attention. And I would say that the 800-pound gorilla in the room is property insurance. And I said it last year, I probably said it the year before that, and I'm going to say it again now. The legislature needs to do more on the issue of property insurance. And candidly and respectfully to my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, and not to make this as a partisan update, but that's the reality of, you know, the state of Tallahassee right now. One side is willing to do something, has come up with ideas, has filed legislation that has not been heard, and the other side is content with what they passed 2 years ago. Show of hands, how many of you have seen your property insurance rates increase? Or get dropped, right? Or not be able to find an insurance company. right? So this is the number one issue. And it doesn't matter, Mr. Mayor, if I'm at Kings Point with the condo commandos. It doesn't matter if I'm in an HOA here. It doesn't matter where I go in my district. The number one issue we hear about is property insurance. And yet, I don't think we've done enough. 2 years ago, we passed a bill. We said, this is going to fix the problem. But it didn't. In my estimation, I read the bill. In my estimation, it was a massive handout to the insurance companies and did nothing for the consumer. It didn't even provide additional transparency. At least if you had paired that funding with some sort of transparency, I'd be more open to it. And when I say transparency, I mean this. I'm a facts and data guy. So when you come and meet with me in my office, and the insurance lobby did, they said, we need these reforms because litigation is killing us. Florida is too litigious, and that's what's driving up our rates. I said, cool. Show me how many cases that you've denied that have gone to litigation. Oh, we can't show you that. How many claims have you settled? Oh, we can't show you that. Right? Any question I asked, I'm sorry to preach to the audience, any question I asked, they couldn't answer that. Right? That's not being transparent. That's not giving the facts and data, and that's not best for the consumer. So my hope is that we will keep the pressure on. It is a bipartisan issue. Your property bill doesn't care about your party affiliation, property insurance bill, rather. And as Commissioner Carter knows, it's one of the biggest issues in this state, and I know that we need to continue to do more on that. So you have my commitment, certainly, to continue to do that. There was one bill I wanted to mention that I filed this year for the first year. That didn't make it all the way across the finish line. We've had some good conversations. I'm hopeful that it'll move forward next year. And that's House Bill 903, Educator Certifications and Trainings. This is based on a conversation I had with a local city commissioner from Coconut Creek, Jeff Wasserman, who also happens to be a school administrator. And we had gone to an event, and we were hanging out after, and we were just kind of talking. And folks, if you don't know, I'm a graduate of Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School. I was on the city commission the day of the shooting. And a lot of what I work on in Tallahassee is school safety, right? School safety, school hardening, mental health reform, reasonable gun reform. And one of the conversations we had was about training and what does the state do now to train our teachers. And it's very hit or miss. And in a lot of cases, what Commissioner Wasserman shared with me is that he'll, everybody kind of comes into an auditorium and they get talked at, right, for a couple hours. Meanwhile, it's in the middle of the semester, they have papers to grade, they have a final exam to write. You know, are they really kind of connecting with the information that's being provided? And I would submit to you that sometimes the case is no. And the number one priority of government should be to protect our kids and make sure that our kids are kept safe. And so this bill would actually, on the front end, require teachers and soon-to-be teachers, whether they're going the traditional education route, in which case it's contained in their curriculum in college, or if they're doing an alternate certification, their certification requirement would include training in how to respond to a mass casualty incident. Not because they're first responders, right? I want them to understand, we want them to understand what to look for, what to listen for, what to do, God forbid something like this happens, and what to do in response. And getting it on the front end so that it's ingrained in that individual, so when they are in that auditorium or when they are in some semblance of training down the line, it's a refresher. It's not the first time that they're hearing it. And yes, Mayor and Commission, it's sad that we have to do that, but that's the reality of where we are today. So I'm not giving up. I will make sure that it passes either in its standalone form or as part of the school safety package next year, and I look forward to bringing it back because I think it's too important to our community and to our state. In closing, Mr. Mayor, I wanted to thank you. I wanted to thank the commissioners. I wanted to thank your staff, candidly, for your advocacy, right? Whether you physically came to Tallahassee, whether you sent me text messages or phone calls or emails on any number of issues that have been going through Tallahassee, it really does matter. And candidly, just don't tell anybody I said this, I wish that some of the other cities across the state would advocate as much and as well as you all do, because your voice is heard loud and clear by your elected officials, and we can then share that with our colleagues in Tallahassee. So thank you for that. I would be remiss if I didn't also thank my Senate sponsor on our appropriation, but also on a number of bills, Senator Polsky, who also represents this area. If Bruce would text me the date of our town hall with Senator Polsky, it's coming up. May 7th, thank you. May 7th, if you all want to get the deep dive, right, in the weeds, if this wasn't long enough for you, come right back to this same room, May 7th at 6 o'clock. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for having us and hosting us. I did want to also give a shout-out. I know you're going to hear from them next, but the Eric's Consultants team, Candace and LJ and Robbie, do a phenomenal job for you in and out of Tallahassee. We literally work hand in glove, trying to get these things done, trying to get your appropriations through the process. It's a great team. They've been a great team for a long, long time, from before I was even on the city commission. So it's been a great working relationship, and I'm really proud of that. And finally, Mr. Mayor, I wanted to give a shout out to my awesome team. As you can tell, between being in Tallahassee as long or being in court every day, I need a good team. And I've been fortunate to have a good team in Bruce Suarez and Kim Schnitzius. If you've been at any of the ribbon cuttings, any event in Coral Springs, Kim Schnitzius is probably there with a smile on her face. She's the heart of this office and goes to everything. And I thank her and couldn't do it without her. And then Bruce Suarez, who is somewhere around here, is stuck with me all the way in the back. It's stuck with me in Tallahassee. So thank you for what you do, Bruce. Bruce is going to be leaving our office. I'm sad to see him go, but he's on to better, bigger and better things. Proud of you. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and pleasure to come. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Dan. Keep up the good work. All right. Come on up, Candace, Lauren. Nice to see you.
I don't know if I can. I was exhausted watching that. But no, I mean, and Representative Daley is fantastic. He's not only, you know, our right hand up in Tallahassee, but he's a good friend. And I just wanted to thank him as he's just left. So that's perfect. But and Senator Polsky as well, and Christine Honchowski, Representative Honchowski, they represent you very well up in Tallahassee. So Candace Eriks with Eriks Consultants, along with Lauren Jackson, just wanted to reiterate what Dan said. Yes, we are very happy to be home from Tallahassee. And I want to thank you all for coming up to Tallahassee and advocating and really doing a great service and the communication that you have. And I want to thank your city manager. He has been fantastic, as well as Catherine. So I'm going to turn it over to LJ to go over a lot of information. She'll try and keep it concise, but I mean, there was a lot going on up there. There was a lot that we were able to stop, but there was a lot that also passed. And if you have any questions, obviously, we can just do an interactive. And if anybody from the audience has any questions and wants to direct them to anybody there, and we can, you know, work with them afterwards, we're happy to do that as well. So thank you for the relationship.
Thank you.
And as Candace said, it was a very, very active session, particularly for local governments this year. I don't want to take too much time because I know that there's a lot of people on the agenda that are waiting to be recognized and some great causes that are coming after us. But just to kind of touch on the highlights, the budget, as Representative Daley mentioned, that was a $117 billion budget, and it did include $800,000 for the Coral Springs Everglades Greenway Loop. And also $500,000 for the RTCC, which Representative Honchowski worked on. And I know you all heard from her last commission meeting. The budget has not yet been sent to the governor, so the shot clock isn't on for that yet. We're still waiting. We have met with the governor's office multiple times on your particular appropriations, and so that's hopefully those will not be vetoed, and that's what we're really hoping for. But that's where we are with the budget right now. I will say as well, we were a little bit disappointed that it was the Coral Springs Everglades Greenway Loop was funded with trust fund dollars instead of general revenue. So that might make it a little bit more vulnerable to veto. But we've had those conversations, and so that's hopefully we're going to be able to avoid that. But I did want to make sure that everyone was aware of that. So to start off with, I want to talk that the Live Healthy initiative passed. The city did adopt, as part of their legislative agenda, an item that would support the Live Healthy initiative or to support healthcare access for residents. And so that bill did pass. It mostly focuses on workforce shortages in the healthcare industry, retention, recruitment, and pathways. And it also funds a lot of health services. It was over $700 million in funding for a lot of health services, increasing Medicaid reimbursements for certain things like dental care, maternity care. Also a major component of that as well was a healthcare innovation council that's funded at $50 million over 10 years. And what that's designed to do is that council will then be able to give out grants to entrepreneurs who come up with innovative ideas, whether they're technology, whether they're workforce pathways, or whether it's service delivery models. And so that could potentially do some really great things in terms of healthcare for the residents here. The rest of her priorities we weren't too particularly fond of, but just to quickly also say that the speaker's number one priority also passed as well, and that was the social media ban for minors, the online protections for minors, which banned social media accounts for 14 and under. Originally, it was 16 and under, but the governor vetoed the original legislation, and it came back to where it's 14 and under, and wait, I'm sorry, under 14, and then 14 and 15-year-olds with parental permission. So that was the version of that passed. But to go back to the rest of the Senate President's priorities, vacation rentals, obviously this is always a battle, a major battle that we have every year, it seems like, and we always have to fight it to the bitter end with lots of twists and turns. This year, the bill did pass, and essentially what it would do is, in previous iterations of the bill, it would have required us to, it would have required operators to first get a local registration prior to applying for a state license. That's not how this version of the bill works. They actually apply first to the state, and the address gets somewhat obscured. They're given an identification number, and then the city's allowed to set up a registration process. First, you have to do a business impact statement if you're going to do that, and then the registration process, as you know, is a one-size-fits-all. It's limited, and as prescribed by the state, you're only allowed to request certain information and take certain actions at certain times. That bill also has not yet been sent to the governor, so the shot clock has not started on that yet. The good part is we were able to get a very high vote count on our side in the House. It passed. It was one of the closest votes in the House. It was 50-61. And that was because some people flipped. We do think that we had the votes going in. And just to let you know as well, this is unprecedented. I've never seen it before, but it was so unpopular in the House that even the Speaker grandfathered his own county prior to the bill passing. He would not allow it to pass unless his county was grandfathered. So that's something I've never seen before. But we got a lot of the governor's allies on our side with that vote, and I know that they went immediately to him to request a veto, and I know that that pressure's been staying on with him, and he is sympathetic to home rule in this instance. So our hope is that he will veto the legislation and we'll be able to continue with our ordinance on the local level, and hopefully it might even put it to bed for a couple years, but I might be getting ahead of myself there, but that's what we're hoping for. So any advocacy, if you want to get with me, if you're looking to advocate to the governor, either on your appropriations or with that veto request, just let me know, and we'll make sure that you get the right information or that we can get that communication to his office. Then along the same lines of the Senate President's priorities, another one of her priorities, and I think this might be the most annoying bill to me of the session, but this is local government actions. As you might recall from last session, SB 170 required local governments to do two things. It was you had to create business impact statements before passing certain ordinances, and then also it created a legal rocket docket system, if you will, where someone could challenge a local ordinance, and it would automatically put an automatic stay on that local ordinance, and then it would create an expedited process for that to move through the court system, and while that's moving through the court system, the ordinance would have an automatic stay on it. So originally this bill would have taken both of those components, and it would have taken one of the exemptions that we were able to negotiate in the previous bill, which would have been for all of growth management ordinances, and it took that and it made it to where it only applies to development orders, permits, and agreements. Originally, like I said, it was for both components of the bill, which really would have just completely stopped growth altogether, because anyone could have challenged any growth management ordinance and it would have been a stay. So thankfully, they ended up, the final version that passed was only related to the business impact statements. So it does mean that you're going to have to do business impact statements for more types of ordinances, but thankfully that the automatic stay part was taken out as it pertains to that. And then for her final priority, I want to touch on the Live Local 2.0 passed as well. So originally, the Senate President wasn't going to do a glitch bill for Live Local. And then after hearing about bad actors on both sides, honestly, both local governments and developers, she decided to move forward with a glitch bill. It was originally a lot more in favor of local governments than what the final product ended up being. But unfortunately, one of the local governments that she was trying to help in the bill, specifically with industrial zones, decided to file a lawsuit. They went forward with a lawsuit after she had already put the legislation out there, said, hey, look, I'm going to fix this. And after they did that, that left her with a, you know, understandably bad taste in her mouth. And a lot of the local government provisions that we supported ended up, unfortunately, coming out of the bill. So it really comes down to just restricting local governments from putting restrictions on floor area ratio FAR and not getting around the density and height restrictions that by doing that. And then also there were provisions that tried to make it to where a live local development could conform to adjacent properties a little bit better. Again, originally the legislation was something a lot better that we supported. The final product is really only if the building is exposed on both on two different sides with a neighborhood of 25 single-family homes or more. So that's when you can restrict the height, I believe, to 150% or something like that. And it also fixed transit-oriented development zones, but that was really what the bulk of it is, the final product that passed. And then moving on to another bill we worked really hard on negotiating, and especially Candace spent a lot of time with the sponsors of this legislation, but that was the residential permitting bill. And it did pass. It wasn't perfect, but it was a lot better than what it could have been. And so thank you to Candace for all the work that you did on that. But the House was very set on its package, and its package was a lot worse. It would have been very truncated timelines. Things would have been automatically deemed approved. And thankfully, the Senate sponsor held strong on his end. He negotiated with us, and he held up to that negotiation, and he refused to take orders from the House, essentially, on that bill. So we were able to get the Senate legislation passed, and essentially what that does is it halves the times rather than 10 days. You know, it's going from 60 to 30 or 60 to 120. The only parts that were still concerning when it passed really had to do with certain multifamily units of 50 units or more, that down to 60 days. There were some jurisdictions that had an issue with that. And then also private provider language that got in there as well. We were really hoping that the private provider language wouldn't get in there, but we did try negotiating, but at the end of the day, that's in there as well. That it requires you to create a standard operating procedure for auditing. It also, I think, further limits the audits, and it gives you from 20 days to 10 days to review and respond to private provider applications. I'm not sure if that's the right term. But some of the good parts in there that we were able to negotiate is we were able to get rid of all the back and forth, the restrictions on how many times you can ask for additional information, et cetera. And then also it allows for building code fees, fee revenue to be used for technology that can help with building code enforcement. So there were a couple of good things at the end of the day that were in that package as well. And then for a bill that didn't pass, sovereign immunity. So sovereign immunity caps have not been raised in 13 years. So the legislature they've had an appetite to increase sovereign immunity caps. We've seen some pretty extreme proposals in the past, but we know it's coming eventually. We know that they want to get something passed, and they've been really wanting to. And this session, it was originally proposed at increasing from 200, 300 to 400, 600. And they were pretty set on that, but there was also an annual adjustment to CPI, and then there was also a provision that allowed political subdivisions to settle above the cap without further legislative action. And that was a really big sticking point as well for local governments. So we were able to negotiate it to where it was adjusting for CPI every 5 years, and then that's capped at 3%. So every 5 years, it would be adjusted for CPI, but then it would be either just go up 3% or CPI, whichever one's less. And doing the calculations, that actually would have allowed it to continue to increase, where maybe they wouldn't be pursuing legislation, but it would have made sure that it was increasing moderately in perpetuity. we were able to get leverage in the House, and we try to take that. We work with a coalition, a sovereign immunity coalition, by the way, that's made up of hospital districts, local governments, school districts, everyone that's impacted, essentially, the sheriff's trust. And so we decided, hey, let's go for a deal, because we know that we're going to keep fighting this fight, and we've heard that the incoming leadership and incoming speaker specifically, they are wanting to increase the limits pretty drastically. So we tried for a deal, and we came very, very, very close to getting the deal passed. It came down to the wire, but that would have been 300, 500, the five-year CPI, and then the sticking point that made it all fall apart, the deal, was allowing the subdivisions to settle without further legislative action. So
I'll allow you a breather for a moment. It's amazing how much you remember without having to look at anything.
Well,
so I'm just admiring you for that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. We lived it, so it's
lived it. Yeah, we can tell. That's cool. All right. Proceed.
Thanks. Yeah, so, like I said, unfortunately, that deal did not go through, and for the first time ever, I was actually rooting for a sovereign immunity bill to pass if we could get that deal, because that means that we're not facing $1 million increase proposal next session. Unfortunately, it looks like that's gonna be the case, and so we're gonna have a major sovereign immunity battle over the next couple sessions in front of us. So just to prepare you guys for that. For a positive bill that passed, there was a cybersecurity liability protection bill that, as long as you meet certain standards and you can show that you're meeting those certain standards, that it provides you some liability protections in cybersecurity incidents. And I also failed to mention as well, as part of the Live Healthy initiative, community mobile action teams were expanded, and that deals with mental health, which I know this commission cares a lot about. And I know you've heard from Representative Fanchowski. I'm sure she spoke about some of her mental health initiatives as well, and obviously Representative Daley just spoke about some of his. But they did expand community mobile action teams. They overhauled the Baker Act and Marchman Acts. So it's definitely something that they focused on and put funding towards this year. And with that, I, like I said, I know a lot of people are waiting to go behind us, and I don't want to take too much time. If there's anything specific I didn't cover, or if you have any questions on anything, happy to respond.
Any questions from the dais?
No questions. Just thank you for being there for us. And I think you're right about sovereign immunity. It'll be back again, just like short-term rentals.
Right.
Mayor, I just want to point out, throughout the legislative session, we get regular updates from Candace and Lauren on what's going on, where bills are, what bills are being proposed, where they are in the process. And then at the end of the year, we get a pass-fail kind of report. So although that sounded like a lot, I can tell you, looking at the reports, it's just a snippet of what happens throughout the legislative process. I just want to put that on the record, that we get a ton of information throughout the whole legislative process on everything that's taking place.
Great. Thank you. Well, we appreciate you. Keep up the good work and look forward to seeing you again in the future.
Thank you. Thank Absolutely. You. Thank you so much. Thank you.
All right. It's time for some proclamations and presentations.
I don't know.
Yep.
Yep.
Oh. All right, Chief, come on down with the telecommunicators. So I'll share a little bit of gratitude, and then I'm going to hand over the mic to our chief of police. Hi again, Kathy. How are you? Hi again. How are you? Nice to see you again. Nice to see you again. Thank you again for your work.
Hi. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you.
How are you?
Come on in, ladies.
All right. So every year, the second week of April is declared as National Public Safety Telecommunicators Week. Men and women are engaged in the operation of emergency response systems for the city of Coral Springs, the city of Parkland, and the city of Coconut Creek. These individuals that are beside us are responsible for responding to phone calls from the general public for police, fire, and emergency medical assistance. They have to make some good conversation on the fly, keep people at peace, and get accurate information, and there's no way our police department would be as wonderful as they are without the telecommunicators. So we want to thank you on behalf of the entire city for the work that you do day in and day out.
So I think appreciate the words there, and look, we could go on and on about the job that our communications center does. I want to thank the commission and the city management for the support to have our own communications center, because not everybody is fortunate to have that, and it does make us better as a police department. It makes us better as a fire department, and you know, I said it earlier today in a message that I don't know if it went to dispatch yet, but we put a message together for them. But you know, you guys are the voice that really, I know as an officer, you know, in those times of need, the voice on the radio, and I'll go back to the days of Barry when he was here. You know, like or not like Barry at the time, you know, personality, he was a little rough around the edges, but when something was going on, you didn't want anybody else on the radio but him. And I know I've also personally had to call our dispatch center for different things, and there's no better feeling than hearing that voice on the other side of the line in that time of need. And again, you guys really do change people's lives. You save lives. And, you know, I'd like to highlight, you know, Shayna in the write-up, the job that was done, you know, recently with a 911 call where CPR was done and the life was saved. Again, it's unbelievable. So again, great job. We appreciate what you do, Mike. I don't wanna...
I won't drag it on, but the same thing that Alec, the police chief, just said. You guys are the unsung heroes. You guys are truly our first responders. I got the opportunity many moons ago to sit up there in those chairs. The stress that goes on, the calm voice on the other side that helps to control what's going on in the home and to establish what we have and what we're responding to and help us is invaluable. Thank you all for everything that you do every day.
So just to add to this, I went to dispatch last night just to, you know, get some more information to understand what it is that they do. You got to be a special person to do that job, to have the calm. I'd be going, stop yelling. I am not one of those people that would be good at the job. I already know that. So thank you so much for what you do, and congratulations. So the city of Coral Springs does have a special proclamation for you. National Public Safety Telecommunications Week is a time to honor those persons, you, who are engaged in the operation of emergency response systems for the city of Coral Springs, the city of Parkland, and the city of Coconut Creek, and throughout the county. Public safety telecommunications personnel are the link between the public and the agencies that provide help. They often work long, hard hours under extremely stressful conditions. These are our nation's unsung heroes who are responsible for helping protect life and property. Therefore, we, the City of Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim the week of April 14th to April 20th as National Public Safety Telecommunications Week in the City of Coral Springs, and signed by your City Commission. Thank you.
My name is Kathy Liriano. I'm the Communications Center Manager for the City of Coral Springs, Parkland, and Coconut Creek. Here I have our Assistant Manager, our Technical Coordinator, Sharon Owens, one of our Emergency Communications Dispatchers, and one of our Training Administrator, Arlene Fernandez. We are truly dedicated to serve our communities. It is an honor to do so. The commissioner said it does take a special person. There's only 1% of the population that can do what we do. And it's very, very taxing. But we do it because we genuinely want to be a helping hand to the community. We don't want to run into burning buildings or to dangerous situations, but this is how we help to keep not only our residents and visitors safe, but also the police officers and firefighters that are family to us. So we appreciate this, and we truly are here to serve each and every one of you. Thank you.
you have a special person among you that got a recognition recently?
So when I was mentioning Sharon Owens, she was recognized yesterday by the Broward County Commission for, it's called the Tom Gallagher Award. So Tom Gallagher was a professional in the public safety emergency communications industry for almost 30 years, and unfortunately he passed over 11 years ago, and this award was created in his honor to show the appreciation for our profession. And Sharon did receive that from the county commission, one of two recognized throughout the county. So we're very proud of her and her accomplishments. She's a very dedicated worker that is really there for her team whenever, you know, there's time that needs to be picked up. You know, she did an excellent job on a fire call recently where there was a multiple fire alarm. So these are the things that we coordinate in the back end. We are like the, like if you, for a Disney movie reference, Cinderella, the little mice that sew and put things together. That's what we do in the back end. And they just work miraculously on the other end for what you guys, to, as the residents and visitors, get to see the first responders do. So we are very grateful to have you part of our team, and I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Give Chief McClellan the other. How are you? Thank you. All right. Yeah.
I'm not going anywhere. This one's mine.
All right. Josh, I'll let you hold on to this for the time being. Chief, you can kick it away.
You want me to start? Okay.
Sure.
So where's our crime victim advocates? And Sergeant Bruno, you want to come up? Captain Myers, you want to come up? So Crime Victims Week is something that was started several decades ago, and just like the dispatchers, you know, we have two victim advocates for our city in the city of Coral Springs. One can't be with us this evening. However, you know, the officers a lot of times get the recognition for the job. You know, we're the first one to get there. We handle the call. We do the paperwork. Again, we make the arrest. But there's another side to it. There's victims of crimes, and there's also the families of those victims, and that's where you come in. And they truly, again, they do change lives. There's times where people don't know what to do. They're the victim of a crime. They've dealt with something that hopefully nobody has to deal with. And again, we get to kind of leave the scene, but you're there for the days and the weeks after, and sometimes even the years after. And I know that the impact you guys have had, unfortunately, we're not immune to serious crimes. We've had significant homicides, and the families, you know, honestly, they don't really remember the officers. They don't remember who showed up. They may remember the detective that investigated the case, but you know who they remember? Our victim advocates and then the job they do. And again, so you guys are changing lives. I'm glad we're able to recognize the job that you do for us. We don't say it enough, so I will say thank you for it. We appreciate you, and we're lucky to have you. So I don't know if you want to say anything.
All right, this is a special proclamation, National Crime Victims Rights Week. National Crime Victims Rights Week provides an opportunity for us to reshape the future for victims by honoring the past and reflecting on hard-won victories, and to recommit working together to insist on better treatment for victims to help them overcome the harm caused by crime. The Coral Springs Police Department is joining forces with victim service programs, criminal justice officials, and concerned citizens throughout the city of Coral Springs and America to raise awareness of victims' rights and observe National Crime Victims Rights Week. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim April 21st to the 27th, 2024, as Crime Victims' Rights Week in the City of Coral Springs.
I will put you on the spot, Nicole, but do you want to say anything? Okay.
Thank you. My partner, who's my other half, is not here, so I'm left speaking by myself. But on our both of our behalfs, we truly love the job that we do, and probably the best part of the job is sometimes that initial phone call or being on scene, and everyone's looking at us like, who are these two young girls? You're not an officer. I don't know who you are. And we introduce ourselves, and they still have no idea what our job title is. But once we explain that to them or the individual, the family, they're kind of just in shock of that there's somebody like us that exists. And in the worst time of their life, we're there to help them out, and it's the best feeling in the world. And for them to say thank you it's a huge thing. So we're happy to do what we do. There's two of us on call 24/7, 365 days a year. But we are very happy to serve the City of Coral Springs and all the victims in it. So thank you.
Thank you.
I promised her that I would, so. I've been supervising Nikki and Hilda, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, for about 2 years. And I can tell you that the difference they make on not just the victims, but family members, relatives that obviously get to unfortunately see the tragedies they deal with. They do a remarkable job with everyone. I still get letters, thank you letters, from cases that have been closed for 2-3 years about how much of a difference they made and how much of an impact they made on the lives of everyone they come in contact with. And it's a pleasure to supervise them. They truly treat every single person they come in contact with like it's person, you know, like it's a member of their family. So we're truly lucky to have them. So thank you.
Thank you. Are we bowing? No badges? Oh, well, we got badges. Okay. So the next proclamation is for Holocaust Remembrance Day. And we have from Temple Beth Orr, Matthew Meyer, to receive it from TBO, and Michelle Goldsmith, Rabbi Goldsmith, Temple Beth Am. Is Rabbi Goldsmith here? Come on up. Is there anybody else here to receive the proclamation? So I'm going to give some background. And then I'll let our recipient share a couple words too. So I requested this. If you've heard me speak before, you know that I am Jewish. I was raised in Washington Heights in New York City. I went to Rabbi Moses Soloveitchik. And when we would learn about the Holocaust as a young person, I would generally have to step out of the room because I couldn't deal with the pain that I heard about. Just couldn't deal with it. And it wasn't until I was in my young 20s that I was able to finally sit through Schindler's List and learn that much more about the Holocaust and the devastation to 6 million Jews and many others. So for those most members of the public who do not live with the thoughts of the Holocaust, the calendar provides two key moments on which to pause and reflect. One that's guided by the Gregorian calendar, and another that's guided by the Jewish calendar. On the 27th of January every year, in the Gregorian calendar, we commemorate International Holocaust Remembrance Day. And then on the 27th of Nisan, in the Jewish calendar, we commemorate what's called Yom HaShoah. Since the Jewish calendar is a lunisolar calendar, each year Yom HaShoah falls on a different date in the Gregorian calendar. This year, Yom HaShoah starts on sundown, Sunday, May 5th, and ends at nightfall on Monday, May 6th. Yom HaShoah has been observed each spring since 1949, almost 60 years before the first commemoration of IHRD. The date chosen to commemorate IHRD reflects the anniversary of the liberation of the Auschwitz-Birkenau by Soviet troops. On Yom HaShoah, we do more than pay our respects. We join them in grief. It is a time to pause, grieve, and consider what was lost. The history of the Holocaust encourages us to reflect on our moral responsibilities to prevent such incidents of hate and prejudice from taking place ever again. It's an opportunity to educate children, share stories, honor the victims of the Holocaust, and recognize the accomplishments of the incredible survivors. We applaud the efforts that individuals, societies, and governments are devoting toward this cause, as well as the efforts to better themselves through education and awareness. Unfortunately, there is still a lot of work to be done, as proved by the surge, unfortunately, in anti-Semitism worldwide. So I'm going to have Commissioner Carter read the proclamation, and then we'll hand it over to both of you.
The City of Coral Springs has a special proclamation for Holocaust Remembrance Day, Yom HaShoah. Did I say that right?
Thank you. Very good.
Okay. Holocaust Remembrance Day, Yom HaShoah, honors the memory of the victims of the Holocaust, as well as the survivors, rescuers, and liberators, and further proclaims that we, as citizens of the City of Coral Springs, vow to protect human dignity and confront hate whenever and wherever it occurs. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim May 6, 2024, as Holocaust Remembrance Day, Yom HaShoah, in the City of Coral Springs, signed by the complete commission.
On behalf of my congregation and the Jewish community of this area, we are very appreciative of this proclamation. There is, unfortunately, still a tremendous amount of Holocaust denial and a very unfortunate upsurge in anti-Semitism. We are blessed to live in an area where that is not quite as prevalent as in some places in either Florida or other parts of the country, but it is top of our minds. And as a child of a Holocaust survivor, my father is 93 and he's a survivor, and there are fewer and fewer of them each year as they all go on to wherever they're going to. And so it's our job to push forward and remember that the depravity of man can get much worse than we might imagine, and it's our job to stand firm and stop it.
All right. So Rabbi, you'll come in the middle over here. So this proclamation is in honor of Jewish American Heritage Month, and I'll give you a brief background. The Jewish American experience is a story of faith, fortitude, and progress. It is a quintessential American experience, one that is connected to the key tenets of American identity, including our nation's commitment to freedom of religion and freedom of conscience. In the month of May, we honor Jewish Americans, past and present, who have inextricably woven their experience and their accomplishments into the fabric of our national identity. Generations of Jewish people have come to this nation fleeing oppression, discrimination, and persecution in search of a better life for themselves and for their children. These Jewish Americans have created lives for themselves and their families and played indispensable roles in our nation's civic and community life, making invaluable contributions to our nation through their leadership and achievements. Each generation made contributions that shaped who we are today, from the early progress of colonies deciding to raise arms against the British, Chaim Salomon, to our courts, Louis Brandeis and Elena Kagan. They continue to build upon the civilization that their forefathers sought. Others brought their scientific knowledge, such as Albert Einstein and Jonas Salk, while a community of business leaders created foundations, Al Fleischman and Monroe Green as a couple of examples. They filled the world of arts with immense talent, entertaining us, including Woody Allen, always cracked me up, Barbara Streisand, J.J. Abrams, creating classic compositions like Irving Berlin, or writing timeless works like Norman Mailer and Ayn Rand. A central concept in Judaism is L'dor V'dor, which means from generation to generation. It recognizes both the continuity of the Jewish people and the intergenerational responsibility. We must heal the world for our children. And with that, I'll let Commissioner Simmons share the proclamation. That wasn't tough.
It's all right. This is a special proclamation for Jewish American Heritage Month. Jewish Americans continue to help our country thrive and prosper. In the month of May, we will honor the timeless traditions, heritage, and contributions of Jewish Americans who drive our progress as a city, county, state, and nation each and every day. The city of Coral Springs pledges to confront bigotry and anti-Semitism wherever and whenever it surfaces. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim May 2024 as Jewish American Heritage Month in the city of Coral Springs.
Glad I didn't speak the first time. So I just want to say thank you to the city, to the commission, to the police department. Since October, when Israel was first attacked, all the way through now, we've seen in Broward County in Florida, across the United States, a rise in anti-Semitism that's realistically unprecedented, maybe since the Holocaust. I know that we've, at Temple Beth Or, and I'm sure at the other temples in the area, are feeling much safer with the protection of the police, with the cooperation of the commission. So thank you guys for your support.
I just wanted to say that it's a wonderful thing that this is going to be for the month of May, because we are going to have Passover, which starts next week. And Passover, the story of Passover begins in the book of Exodus. It says that that after the Israelites were invited to live there, a new Pharaoh rose up in Egypt who knew not the Israelites and Joseph anymore. And to a certain extent, that's kind of how the Jewish community around America is feeling, that people have forgotten that we have been productive members of the American experience for hundreds of years, and all of a sudden there's this tremendous anti-Semitism resurgent. And so the last day of Passover is April 30th, basically, or 29th, 30th. And so to start the very next day with Jewish American Heritage Month is very nice. And I just want to say thank you.
Our next proclamation is Fair Housing Month. Who's coming from staff? Is Nira here? Yes. All right, great. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you. I'll let you share that.
Okay. All right, this is a special proclamation for Fair Housing Month. The City of Coral Springs is committed to highlight the Fair Housing Law, Title VIII of the Civil Rights Act of 1968. By continuing to address discrimination in our community, to support programs that will educate the public about the right to equal housing opportunities, and to plan partnership efforts with other organizations to help assure every American of their right to fair housing. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim April 2024 as Fair Housing Month in the City of Coral Springs.
Come on in the middle.
Oh, is it on?
Yes, ma'am. Awesome. Mic's always on.
Oh, yeah. All righty. So thank you, Mr. Mayor, Commissioners. On behalf of Hope Fair Housing Center in Broward County, we would just like to thank the City of Coral Springs for recognizing April as National Fair Housing Month. I'm always saying that it's great when cities recognize it. That means they know the importance of affirmatively furthering fair housing. And we've celebrated 56 years of fair housing this April 11th. So thank awesome. You guys again.
Oh, yes. Well, I just wanted to thank Charmaine for all their hard work at Hope Inc. for protecting the right to fair housing, which in turn is protecting human rights, dignity, fairness, respect, and just equal opportunity for all members of our society. So thank you so much.
Okay, we are recognizing some outstanding volunteers in our community for work that they've done in our community. This is called the Lynn Johnson Award for Outstanding Volunteerism. And Lynn Johnson had been a fantastic volunteer for us for many years, and we named it after her. This comes through the Community Involved Government Committee. So I'll give you some background, and then we're going to call up the first winner. Background is the City of Coral Springs prides itself on community-involved government and providing quality services to our residents. And you as volunteers play a critical role in that role that we play for all of you. Our volunteers help the city by providing important services and programs that might not normally receive funding. Lynn Johnson happened to epitomize the Coral Springs volunteer spirit, and she was one of the first recipients of what was then called the Bridge the Gap Awards in June of 2009. After her passing, a couple of months later, the award was renamed in her memory. And we want to thank the Community Involved Government Committee for coordinating the subcommittee and selection of this year's recipients. So our first winner is Casey Ardrin. Commissioner Simmons will bring that to, we'll have Casey come on up. She's got some fans. Congratulations. We're going to put you right in the middle. You can't take the award and run, so sorry. So I'll share with you some background information on Casey. She's very motivated, thankfully, to help animals in need. She also understands that there's more to running a shelter than just cleaning and feeding. She does laundry, helps with paperwork, bathes animals, does dishes. Could use you at my house. She's always been the first to volunteer when there is a serious need. She can be counted on to drop everything and assist. Casey's ambition is contagious, not only to her peers, but to her family as well. Very proud that you're going to be going to FSU very shortly. Her passion ignites others to get involved. She's a young lady that others should aspire to be like. Many times, the entire family has helped the Humane Unit with needs and support. She's an inspiration to those that she meets and is truly making a difference in Coral Springs. Thank you and God bless you.
Okay, come on down, Valerie, for seniors making a difference. You're awesome. Valerie is a valuable member of the Community Involved Government Committee. She participates and volunteers in many city activities and events like the International Peace Walk, Socrates Club meetings, Coral Springs Police Department Citizens Ambassador Program, meetings, and the Festival of the Arts. She completed the Citizens Police Academy program last year. She also volunteers at the Coral Springs Police Department Summer Camp for the underprivileged. Her passion and commitment impact the lives positively. Thank you, Valerie.
Thank you so much. I just want to say thank you to Mayor, Commissioners, and to this great city that I love for the opportunity to serve.
Awesome.
It's a pleasure. I love it. Thank you.
We love you.
Chuck, where you at? Come on down. Committed to enhancing city services, Chuck James. Chuck has a passion for people and truly enjoys helping others. He has taken it upon himself to pass along CPR course offerings to the community via his CERT duties because he wants to help the community stay informed. His care for the communities of Coral Springs citizens in general, the teens at the Coral Glades High School, and the CSRIPS has made a difference. He is always ready to help and truly cares about representing himself, CSRIPS, CERT, and other city and our city in the most positive way possible. So much so that the fire department administration team has noticed Chuck's dedication and has been asking for his assistance as well. Congratulations, Chuck.
I moved here about 5 years ago, and I wanted to make a difference, and I appreciate the things that Coral Springs has allowed me to do. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, sir. We're going to have a picture. So while this winner is not here, actually Audrey passed not too long ago, I'd like to share about Audrey and why she won this award. So this category is enhancing the lives of Coral Springs residents. And the winner is Audrey Ellen. You would lead the peace walks that so often Commissioner Carter and I would go on. Joe would join us many times, other people in the community. And she led the peace walk for the past 5 years. Whether it was raining or not, she'd be there bright early and always just with a big contagious smile, always with love and peace in her heart. And it was just always a pleasure to be around her and take the peace walk that was led by her. Her daughter was here earlier to be recognized at the dinner, at the reception. We have the Peace Walk the first Saturday of every month at the Peace Garden, right next to the Museum and Center for the Arts. As a diverse community, it's very important that we come together and we pray for peace for our country, for our state, and for our community. And Audrey was able to orchestrate that the first Saturday of every month beautifully, with big heart and just a lot of love. And I always felt peaceful walking away. Peace is an integral part of our community, and on behalf of the entire city, we thank Audrey in heaven for being so committed for so many years. So if you can all please give Audrey a round of applause.
I personally work side by side with Audrey. She was also part of the clergy coalition and frequently served at our Unity, what's the one we have at Thanksgiving? Interfaith, thank you, the Interfaith Unity. She was just very spiritually grounded and someone who, when you interact with them, you feel better. And it's just a sad loss. But thank you for your honoring her.
Yeah, it's a very sad loss. This one for Joseph. Joseph Martinez, come on down. You are the next winner on the Volunteers' Right. So I'll share some personal words about Joseph. Joseph comes with such enthusiasm every day. Every day, he comes with great ideas. He's been an integral member of the Community Involved Government Committee. He's been an ambassador to the city. And let me tell you, when you walk into a room, Joseph, it's lighter, it's funner, more playful, and I just love being around you, and you deserve this award, and I'm very proud to know you and proud to work with you. Congratulations.
I'll make it short. Thank you to the city of Coral Springs. I love volunteering for Coral Springs. I encourage everybody to volunteer for Coral Springs. I feel very appreciated here. I feel honored to be winning this award, and to all the other colleagues that also did win, congratulations to you. And yeah. Everything under the sun. And thank you so much, everybody that came out. Thank you, thank you.
Awesome. You got a good fan club. And for the other winners, after this picture, if you'd come up for a picture with all the winners, we'd appreciate it if you're still around, okay? So we'll get this one first. So Jennifer, you coming on down for this? Yeah, sure. You're welcome to come join us. Hi, Jennifer. How are you?
I'm good.
Good. So I'm going to give some background. So we have proclaimed April as Autism Awareness Month in the amazing city of Coral Springs. The first National Autism Awareness Month was declared by the Autism Society in April of 1970. The aim of this awareness effort is to educate the public about autism, which is a complex mental condition and developmental disability characterized by difficulties in the way a person communicates and interacts with other people. Autism can be present from birth or form during early childhood, typically within the first 3 years. It's a lifelong developmental disability with no single known cause. People with autism have a set of symptoms unique to themselves, and it's very important that we as a community, we educate others about this disability. No two people that have autism are the same. While there is no cure for autism, it is well documented that individuals with autism who receive treatment early in their lives can reduce their symptoms and improve their life functions. The City of Coral Springs values all of its residents. Therefore, multiple programs are geared towards our special populations, including specialized summer camps, dinner clubs, bowling leagues, dances, and more. This year, we have a Touch a Truck event. It's an opportunity for children with special needs to interact with emergency vehicles, meet our amazing first responders, and register for a special needs database. This year's event will take place on Saturday, April 20th at Mullins Hall from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. The special needs database is another important way for the city's first responder teams to know how to address situations and for the citizens to feel safe in case of an emergency. We encourage everyone with a disability, impairment, or cognitive delay to join the Coral Springs Special Needs Database. Serving Up Love is another great example of an opportunity for those with special needs. Coral Springs tennis instructor Dan Bobrow offers free tennis lessons for young children on the autism spectrum as part of Love Serving Autism, which is a nonprofit organization. The group meets on select Saturdays at Cypress Tennis Courts, enjoying a warm and positive teaching style, including the use of specialized visual cues. Dale, would you like to share something else?
Always willing to say a couple nice things. So the city's been recognizing autism and trying to help educate others about it for many years. Started back before COVID, we started actually doing this. So we're glad to bring this proclamation forward for this year. And the chief was gonna do a plug for some of the upcoming events, but I think you covered it all, Mayor. Go ahead, anyhow.
Well, I was going to say, actually, I appreciate you did cover everything very well. Great job on that. But I did want to ask maybe if Monica Vargas and Hannah Racon could come up here, because you guys, come on, you can't sit there. And as they're walking up, you know, the reason why I asked them to come up is we're talking about the programs that we do here and the outreach that we have here, but the truth of the matter is it really is Monica and Hannah who the lion's share of the work. And one event that the mayor didn't mention on was, you know, one that we do, it's Lion Star Academy now. It's a special needs school down on University Drive, and we go there for the holidays and we do a toy drive and gifts and give the kids. And there's joy on the kids' face, but I'll tell you what's almost equally as enjoyable is the pleasure and the joy on the faces of the parents, that it gives them that kind of sense of, you know, their kids are experiencing, you know, that outreach, those gifts, the interaction with us. It is truly amazing. And again, just like we thanked a lot of people tonight, I didn't want to leave you guys out and without let you sit back there and say thank you for what you do. Again, you're impacting people's lives, you're changing lives, which is ultimately what we want to do. So thank you guys.
Mayor, if I could, I just want to give Jennifer a shout out here. She is an active mom who's looking to try to make things better for her children and others in the community. She's been in communication with myself, with Catherine, with Rob Hunter on several occasions, sharing a lot of good ideas with us about things we can do in the city to even take things forward and consider it for the future. So thank you for being here and willing to accept the proclamation tonight.
All right, so this is a special proclamation for Autism Awareness Month. We should all learn more about autism to improve early diagnosis, to learn more about the experiences of autistic people from autistic people, and to build more welcoming and inclusive communities to support people with autism. Therefore, we, the City Commission of Coral Springs, proclaim April 2024 as Autism Awareness Month in the City of Coral Springs.
Do you want to hold this? I did jot something down. I am going to speak in public speaking comments, but if I'm going to get more time, I'm going to use it. Something quick. So thank you to the mayor, vice mayor, commission, and all city officials for awarding me with this tonight. I am beyond flattered to be able to accept this, not only on behalf of my amazing son, Jake, who's home sleeping, but the whole autism community here in Coral Springs. My son, Jake, is 5 years old, and while this has been quite the journey so far, we are just getting started. I am thrilled that the city has recognized that it's time to increase our special needs programming and inclusion efforts. 1 in 36 children are being identified with autism. These children are different, not less than, and are deserving of the opportunity to participate in programs in Coral Springs alongside their siblings, friends, and neighbors. With increased programming, the community in Coral Springs will become more comfortable interacting with people with disabilities. They will come to understand that people with autism are like them in many ways and have their own sets of strengths. They will learn empathy and learn to see the person first and not the disability. Thank you again to the City of Coral Springs. This recognition means so much to me.
Okay, now that we've done all the presentations and proclamations, we can start the rest of our meeting. I love that part of our program, and it's great to recognize volunteers. I think, you know, recognizing certain categories of people, such as those on the spectrum, is very important. We really are a very inclusive community. I think if there was a competition in the country, we can't imagine we wouldn't be in the top five. And one of the reasons I love living here, let alone being the mayor, is I feel welcomed all the time, everywhere. And that's certainly one of my goals as the mayor and as a peer and neighbor, is that anybody that comes into Coral Springs, lives here, visits, they feel welcome. We have public hearing, public comment. I know we have some speakers, so let me give you guys some ground rules for the public comment. Sometimes people would like to engage us as a city commission with your comments or questions. Typically, we don't get engaged during the comment section, but we might share some of our ideas and responses during commission comments later on. I know a lot of times, people are very excited about something, so I'm going to ask you, if you're real excited in a positive way, to go like this instead of clapping so we can move things along. Yes, that's a perfect example. And if you're not so thrilled with what a speaker says, it's fine to go like this. Please don't boo them. Okay. And with that, our first speaker.
Jennifer Levy.
You get the mic twice in a row. How much time do you need? You have 4 minutes. Sounds good.
I'm Acceptance Month, and I'm here to speak about my vision for the city. When we first moved to Coral Springs, we did so with the dream of living in a safe community with excellent schools, fantastic parks, and a wide variety of well-run parks and rec programming. My youngest son, Jake, as I just mentioned, is 5 years old, and he is autistic. He has two older siblings who throughout the years have been able to enjoy our beautiful city parks and have participated in tons of activities and sports. Sadly for Jake, I have to bring him to other cities for adaptive sports and for camp. I love my city, and I so desperately would love to see Jake have the opportunity to participate in more activities here where we live so that he too can feel that sense of community and so that we can connect with other families and make lasting friendships like we have via our other children. Please look to other cities that are successfully demonstrating real inclusivity, starting right here in our own backyard with Pompano Beach. They have 4 weekly programs for people with special needs, all age groups, plus quarterly events and a sensory van at all city events. They have a dedicated staff member who oversees all inclusion and special needs programming and trains city staff. Rockville, Maryland has a special playground, a basketball court, where individuals with varying exceptionalities can shoot hoops. The National Association for Recreational Equality is a nonprofit organization that helped them create that and can possibly help our city with our parks. Mesa, Arizona is the first autism-certified city. What an accomplishment. An autism-certified city is one where key stakeholders, including healthcare, education, local government, hospitality, are trained and certified to better serve individuals with autism. This can be a big dream that we can try to achieve one day here in Coral Springs. But first, baby steps. While I love that the city has revamped the special needs programming website and you are off to a great start, I'd like to see more. Other than the once per year touch a truck, there is nothing for my 5-year-old. I love the concept of love serving autism, but my son doesn't have the motor planning skills yet to play tennis. While I also think it's great that the dance and gymnastics classes at the gym are open to all students, will the teachers know how to modify their verbal instructions? Will the teacher know that it's going to be hard for Jake to pay attention to verbal instructions with loud music in the background? Will the teacher know that my son requires hand-over-hand assistance to do the dance moves? Will the dance recital be inclusive to him? Will the costume be itchy? Will it be uncomfortable? These are the things that we need to consider, and we know right now the answer to these questions are no. My ask tonight is, 1, hire a dedicated staff member to run special needs programming. This person should have Parks and Rec experience coupled with experience working with special needs. 2, block off an hour or two before all city events to be a sensory hour so our kids can attend events before the crowds. 3, keep in mind we need programming for all ages. Little elites via Special Olympics that Pompano has is a great start. 4, make sure staff is trained on how to work with a special needs population. You can partner with CARD at NOVA and with the Society of Autism in Florida. I've been in touch with city officials. I'm so excited that the city is so receptive to these ideas. More inclusion in our city will lead to more knowledge and empathy towards people with special needs. Right now, I take Jake to our local parks, and when children try to initiate play with him, they don't understand why he doesn't talk. If Jake is squealing or screaming or flapping his hands, I see people staring at him. Sorry, I wanted to stay composed, but I'm very passionate about this. My dream is that one day autism will be so widely known that people will see Jake and know that he's autistic rather than staring at him.
I share that dream with you.
Thank you. And that starts with more programming in our city. As a mom who lives and breathes this 24/7, I'm willing to assist you in whatever capacity I can. Coral Springs' motto is everything under the sun. Let's make sure that our special needs population is getting everything under the sun also. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you. You can clap for her. I'll allow that.
Thank you.
And I'm fine with that because of you're touching us, you know, and I know this touches your life, you know, very deeply. Would you mind sharing just one more time about that sensory hour that you're suggesting?
Yeah, so my idea was, I love how Pompano has a sensory van,
okay,
so that if you're overwhelmed in at an event, you can go and have a quiet break in the van. You don't have to go home.
Okay.
But let's take it one step further. Let's open up the event an hour or two early so that special needs people can go and have fun at the event before they have to wait in long lines, before crowds come, before it's overwhelming to them.
Gotcha.
I think that's such an easy thing that we could do.
I'll be happy to talk to you offline if you have any time on Friday. I have fair free time. If you can just call me on my cell, I'd love to talk to you more.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Mayor, if I may, we also have the list. Jennifer, thank you for sending it over.
Yes.
We have the list, and so we have all that documented, what the recommendations are.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Wonderful. Thank you. And thanks for being so receptive.
Yes. Thank you.
All right. And our next speaker?
Amy Youngblood.
All right, but from now on, it's this, okay? Please. Amy?
Amy Youngblood.
Okay. Next speaker?
Sebastian Mordis.
Good evening, Sebastian.
Good evening. Dear Mr. Mayor, dear city commissioners, I am Sebastian, the father of a five-year-old autistic child. And as the father, I urge the commission to consider adding additional initiatives. The first initiative would be an expansion of the Touch and Truck program called Badge and Ladder Sensory Extravaganza. It would help invite a partnership between the Coral Springs Fire and Police Departments, local businesses, and special needs service providers to host special events, at least one to four of these special events in Mullins Park. It would help create a supportive and outreach environment where the whole community can enjoy lots of fun, activities, food, safe bounce houses, inflatables, lots of info tents where the parents could learn about those local businesses and special needs service providers. These events would include access to fire trucks as well as police motorcycles, and then petting zoos, as well as other fun and safe initiatives. It would aim to create a dedicated, safe, and fun experience for the whole community to learn as much about autism as they can. The second initiative would be called Safe Gym. It would aim to create a dedicated safe gym in the city. This gym will have fully trained staff and be equipped with sensory-sensitive design and safety measures. Regular gyms, unfortunately, have a lot of things like dangerous swings and dangerous zip lines and other things that can hit the child. They do not know that the danger is there. This gym could be easily built to really help them be able to enjoy child-led exploration of the entire facility, as well as have controlled access, because autistic kids tend to want to wander off and escape, and so that would help the parents have a chance to just observe and make sure that they're having fun. By establishing such a safe gym, we would ensure that our city is a haven for all families, especially those with special needs kids. In summary, these programs represent an investment in the hearts and minds of our future generations. They signal to Floridians that Coral Springs is the leader among cities and a champion for individual kids with special needs. I thank you for your consideration and for making these proposals one day a reality for the betterment of our cities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sebastian. And our next speaker.
Ida Mordez.
Hello.
Hello, everybody. It's a really pleasure to be here and being able to talk. I wasn't really prepared to to say anything. I want to give my time to Jen, but I have this opportunity. My idea is a little bit bigger and a little bit more in the future, because those little kids who have special needs, some of them are high functional, some of them they are not. And it's hard when they are adult, and I'm sorry, I'm crying. It's hard when they are adult, they just lack at home, or they don't have a place to go. My idea, and I'm volunteering my time, and whatever I can go and do and collect the money, open like a non-profit organization when city will help create the home for them. Not really home, but the place to go. Place to go, they can play, they can receive services there, like some kind of occupational therapy. But the place when parents can leave them, they know they are safe, the cameras are everywhere, nurses are there, some kind of medical people are there, but place when they can go and be there safe, when parents can go to work, and they come back and pick them up. I know my idea is a little bit older, like the kids, it's so many special, and I'm so sorry, I'm crying. It's so many special needs, not only autism, but special needs kids who don't have a place to go when they are older. I'm talking about 22, it's no school for them, nothing. So if you can put your notes, and maybe in the future we can build beautiful school for that reason, I really, really appreciate. Thank you.
And our next speaker?
Our next speaker is Chris Columbus.
Great name. He must be touring.
Isabella Barrera.
Welcome, Isabella.
Dear members of the Coral Springs City Commission, my name is Isabel Martinez, and I am a registered behavior technician and work with neurodivergent children. I address you today to advocate for the increased resources and support for parents seeking information about public, private, and nonprofit schools, as well as comprehensive special needs programs in our community. It is crucial that parents have access to fully staffed programs with well-trained staff and easy accessible resources to make well-informed decisions about their children's education. I would like to mention Best Buddies International, the world's largest organization dedicated to ending the social, physical, and economic isolation of those with intellectual and developmental disabilities. Here in Florida, they provide friendship programs and clubs in elementary, middle, and high schools that allow children with and without intellectual disabilities to build one-on-one friendships, offering social interaction while improving the quality of life and level of inclusion for a population that is often isolated or excluded. As someone who participated in a Buddies program all 4 years of high school, I saw the huge impact that it had not only on these wonderful children, but also the inclusion, compassion, and empathy that it created on the neurotypical children. And if it wasn't for that club, I don't think I would be pursuing a career in this field. That being said, it is quite sad and discouraging that only two schools in the city of Coral Springs have this club, one middle school and one high school. Before there can be any acceptance and inclusion, awareness and education are needed. Furthermore, I urge the commission to prioritize the creation of opportunities for children with special needs, including autism, to experience social interactions and job training programs in safe and enjoyable environments. Every child deserves the chance to develop social skills, form connections, and have fun in a supportive setting that caters to their unique needs. By expanding resources for parents and providing more opportunities for social interaction, we can create a more inclusive and supportive community for children with special needs. I urge you to make it a goal that the city of Coral Springs becomes a leader when it comes to welcoming this population and providing flexibility, inclusivity, and acceptance. Let us work together to ensure that every child has a chance to thrive and experience the social interactions that they deserve. Thank you for your attention and consideration of these important matters. Thank you.
You're welcome. Very eloquent, Isabella. Thank you for being here. And our next speaker?
Sonia Hernandez.
Okay, next one.
Zoe Mordas.
Welcome, Zoe.
Welcome.
How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for the mayor and the city commissioners, and I would like to thank everybody that is here tonight. I am Zoe Mordas, and I'm an older sister of my brother, John. He is 5 years old, and he has autism. As a sister, I feel very sad in the fact that I get to go to amazing camps that have field trips, and I have professionals trained in dance and cheer that are very affordable, while my brother has limited options and my parents have to pay $700 a week and have to drive very far. And it's just not my family, but tons and tons of people also agree with this statement. In conclusion, I ask for a safe, fun, and affordable special needs camp that makes them feel accepted in Coral Springs. Thank you.
Thank you, Zoe. You did a wonderful job. You have a lot of people raising their hands for you. Also very eloquent, Zoe.
Our next speaker? Our next speaker is Amanda Nicole.
Okay, we'll do the next one.
Daniela Levy.
I love your enthusiasm, Daniela.
Hi, my name is Daniela Levy, and I'm 8 years old. I have a little brother named Jake, and as you probably know from my mom, that he has autism. Like my mom, I would like everyone to have something, but not only autistic people, but all people with disabilities to also have things to do. All people are human beings. I want people to know that having autism doesn't mean you're less than anyone to be able with disabilities. I want the city to have lots of activities to choose from, like to play sports, do art classes, and etc. I would like to thank the city for listening to me and my mom, and to thank the city for making changes. Thank you all for staying to hear me, my mom, and thank you to all those people and the ones who are also going to give speeches to help. Thank you.
You did a wonderful job. Thank you so much. Very nice, very nice. Your brother's lucky to have you.
Our next speaker is Michelle Rostinsky.
Good evening, Michelle. You can be at that mic.
Hello.
I don't know if I can top these kids. They're amazing. So hi, thank you. I'm a mom of three boys with hidden disabilities. Hidden disabilities are non-visible disabilities, which includes not only autism, but anxiety, mental health, sensory processing disorder, ADHD, MS, brain injury, epilepsy, and partial sight and hearing loss. It is important that our cities have programs available for all children of all ages with all abilities. Programs should be offered year-round, not just once a year or twice a year. And they should include sports, music, art, dance, STEM activities, and community involvement. Not only is having these programs crucial, but hiring the right staff who are well-trained and well-versed is needed. These staff will oversee the programs, train others, and make sure that the programs are run correctly and meet the needs of our families. Utilizing teens and young adults in our community as volunteers to buddy up with our children in these programs would be very helpful in not only making these programs successful, but teaching the, not only the children, but the young adults how important it is to advocate for each other. It's a rewarding experience for all involved. Please help make Coral Springs everything under the sun. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Robert Fogle.
Good evening, Robert.
Good evening, everybody. Cypress Run South, Robert Fogle. You know, I'm listening to these young kids, and it wasn't part of my speech tonight. I have a son that has epilepsy, and this city spends a lot of money on a lot of things, and it's in the budget and so on and so forth. I'd like to see what these people have talked about for special needs to happen, and to happen fast. We want to move on item number 13. We want to spend $150,000 to move a piece of art. Let's put that $150,000 towards this right here. We want to spend on item number 14. We're going to go from $45,000 to $250,000 in spending. Let's carve out some of that money and put it towards this effort. Number 16, we want to spend $117,500 for software. Can we get it a better price? Can we do what we have to do to make this happen? Because we do need our city to take care of special needs people. CPI, if anybody doesn't know what CPI is, Consumer Price Index, earlier this month went up 5% on top of the 33% that we have experienced in the last 3 years. It's incredible what's going on with the cost of goods and the cost of living in our society. We need to carve out and spend less for sure and make sure that these kind of things are needed. We used to call it in business a war chest or a accruing money for certain things that we need to do. One of the things that happened to me in business is that the city of Sunrise gave me $210,000 to restore closed Publix that I purchased. And we need to do some of that stuff right here for the landlords, for the businesses, for our community to make life a little bit better. That store today, I did very well there. Publix wanted to knock me out. They came in into my store. Management from corporate came in and said, we're going to take you down because they didn't approve of it. And fortunately, Pat Salerno, city manager, made it happen. So that store is still there today, and it's part of that community. More importantly, Mr. Mayor, I want to thank you for the Jewish recognition tonight. I lost two aunts that I never knew during the Holocaust. And it's a shame what's going on in this country, and I blame it on the educational system that we don't, we allow people to discriminate against any kind of faith. And I thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you. Any other speakers?
Our next speaker is Tiffany Wheeler.
Tiffany, your hand's tired?
Oh,
I'm not as prepared as the young ladies. And no I don't worries, normally no write worries. Stuff down. And I was late because I was getting an eraser stuck from my son's ear. And on that note,
I'm sorry.
My 17-year-old son has very high-functioning Asperger's. And I would like to ask you guys, when you're thinking about all of the accessibility, to think all of the spectrum. For the teens and the tweens and the people that are picked last on teams, they're not quite spectrum-y enough to be included for some things, but they're not noticeably handicapped for the others. When my son was on I-9 and the coach said, everybody has to pass in this order and it wouldn't happen, he had a fit on the floor and now he was the weird kid. These coaches didn't understand, the kids didn't understand. He's also a self-proclaimed inside boy. You have chess tournaments, but no chess classes. There's nothing for the inside kids. There's no D&D club or learning gaming or stuff where these kids could work with mentors. My son has a 4.3 and is graduating this year from Stoneman Douglas. I've been lucky enough, inspired by him, to start substituting, and I want you guys to know you should be very proud. You have autism clusters that are amazing at Country Hills, at Eagle Ridge, at Westchester. I've worked personally with them, and they call me and say, hey, can you sub, because I work specifically with these kids. Coral Springs Elementary, and I'm now the interim sub for the PASS program at Coral Glades. And they have amazing programs for these kids where they go out in the PASS program, which are your super seniors, to go out into the community and work. They go to Burlington, they go to the dollar store, they organize stuff, they try to get them. But unfortunately, high spectrum kids fall through the cracks. There is just not enough to help them. It wasn't until a teacher in third grade told the rest of the kids why my son was the way he was, till he got invited to birthday parties and until anybody came to his. There's nothing worse than a neighbor having a party who goes to the same school who doesn't invite you because you're weird. And there's just not enough for them to understand when things get too loud, when things get too busy, that there's just not, they're not there. And I would like to see that you guys open that up when you guys are building, because I know that you plan, but when I see 10 events for, or 10 opportunities for people over 55 and 2 for special needs on your website, I'm very disheartened. I'm glad to hear that you have things planned, but my son is too old for touch a truck. But autism doesn't stop at 5, it doesn't stop at 10. Sometimes it doesn't stop at 50, and there needs to be activities for everyone.
Thank you for being here. Thank you. Anyone else signed up?
Mayor, final signed speaker is Robert Weiner.
Good evening, Robert.
How are you?
Good.
Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak to you. I want to speak about children, basically. That's why I'm here, but in a different sense. I live in the Forest Hills area, been there for 38 years. I live right on the corner of 28th Street and Forest Hills Boulevard. And my reason for coming is to make you aware of the problem that we have there with speeding. It's a major corner, 28th Street and Forest Hills. There's only stop signs on the two side streets, 28th Street and on both sides. Nothing on Forest Hills Boulevard now. My main reason is to coincide kind of with the families of children, is the fact that there's a school right nearby there on Forest Hills Boulevard, if you're familiar with Forest Hills, the elementary school. They don't slow down. I'm an early riser. I'm up at 7:30 in the morning, and they are flying. It says 25 miles an hour. You might as well not have signs up there. What I'm saying is, for the children's sake mostly, because I've seen two kids almost get hit by cars. Number one, they don't slow down for damn near anything. I've contacted the police department. They do what they can, but it's a temporary thing. Once in a while, they send motor patrol over and they gun, and they write tickets, but it's not constant. We need something permanent. Now, there are two things I've spoken about before. I was here before. I contacted the city. I contacted the county. The county bounces it back to the city. The city bounces it back to the county. First, I asked for speed bumps. They said, can't do it on Forest Hills Boulevard because it will impede rescue or fire if they have to go to a fire. Yet there are speed bumps on the side streets all along, everywhere, on the side streets, you know, 94th Street, 36th Street. You can count them. There are 3 to 5 on almost every block, but they can't do it there. They say they can't do anything unless there are unless there are a lot of driveways. That's why they have them there. On 28th Street alone, there are 5 driveways. I don't know how many you need, you know, for requirements. What I'm saying, in essence, without wasting too much time, is the fact that something permanent needs to be done on 28th Street and Forest Hills Boulevard, because at 7:30 in the morning, they're flying. Okay, and at 5:30 at night, they're flying, and they don't care about the 25-mile zone. They fly right past the school, go right around the bend, and they take right off. Sooner or later, somebody's going to get hurt. I once already had, too late? Do I get another 30 seconds?
10 seconds.
I already had a pickup truck lose control and come into my backyard through my hedge, and the officer that investigated said if it wasn't for the orange tree that I had there, it would have been sitting in my living room. So I want somebody to do something.
I have no doubt that we're going to take a look at what we can.
Please do somebody, because this is the second time I've been here and nothing's been done. They didn't even contact me, the people that were supposed to. I won't mention names.
We hear you.
Please, for the children's sake, if nobody else, the kids are all there.
Gotta have you sit down.
Thank you.
Would somebody else from the public like to be heard? And come on up. And Zoe, when you're old enough, you have my vote for mayor.
Good evening. My name is Anna Oliveira. I'm here to support Jennifer. I work for school with a large number of special needs kids, and I see the important work for summer camp. So if you can have an affordable summer camp for the parents, and also to continue the good work that the school provides for the special needs kids, will be wonderful. Thank you, Jennifer, for advocate for our community and for special needs kids.
Thank you, I ditto that. Anybody else would like to be heard? Come on up. And Anna, we might need to get your address if you didn't state it.
I was going to say, no one's given addresses.
And you can just share with the clerk privately.
Yeah. Jonathan Korb, 4613 North University. Thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. You're supposed to be playing kickball on Friday, I've heard. I know Dan was out there. I'm just saying, we need to see you this Friday. But hey, okay, we'll let it slide. We'll let it slide. We'll let it slide. But this Friday, we're counting on it. We need some FAU out there. All right. My entire life, I guess do you have a question? Oh, I thought you gave me. We're good? Okay. My entire life, I guess I've been blessed. You know, I've had healthy family, healthy lives. I did grow up, I had an older sister, was deaf. My parents worked through that through their whole life and was, you know, great through that experience and everything that they did. Heck, my sister had to go up to St. Augustine to go to school at the time. But my personal life outside of that, I've been blessed. My kids are great. I got a daughter at FAU, son that goes to Archbishop High School in Southwest. So I've been blessed along those lines. So directly, no, I haven't been affected by autism or anything like that, but indirectly, in meeting my neighbors and becoming part of their lives, Jen is amazing. My next door neighbor is amazing. I've met these people and realized, you know what, there's more that we all can do, even though we're not directly involved. So I just want to let you know, I'm supporting Jen and her cause, and if you need to know that there's people out there also that don't have kids with autism and all that are here to support. And I know you guys are great and you're going to make it happen. So just here to let you know, let's get to it. Thank you. Thank you.
Would anybody else like to be heard? You can.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioner, and the residents of Coral Springs. I don't like public speaking, but I'm here to say something about having a child with autism.
Would you state your name and address for the record?
I registered.
Perfect.
I registered.
Good. Thank you. Tell us your name.
Thank you. My name is Katarzyna. I moved to Coral Springs 3 years ago. 7 years ago, my daughter was born with congenital heart defect. Later on, I found out that she has cortical vision impairment. And then later on, I found out that she is autistic. Many challenges, many unknowns. I don't know what the future holds for her, but we wanted to move into Coral Springs to give her the opportunity of good schools, and hopefully with everything that Jennifer is advocating for, that would come forward and we can feel, you know, that we are being heard and that our kids are being heard, that Isabella is being heard. I thank you, and I trust that you are going to help us.
Thank you. Nice to meet you. Would somebody else like to be heard from the public? All right, seeing none, public comment is closed. We're moving on to consent. Oh, I'm sorry. Number 9, Ordinance 2024-110. It's the first reading of the Charter Amendment relating to election and terms of office.
All right, this is Ordinance Number 2024-110, an ordinance of the City Commission of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, submitting to referendum an amendment to the Charter of the City of Coral Springs, Section 3.02, entitled Election and Terms of Office for Commissioners, Mayor, and Vice Mayor, relating to terms of office for the Mayor and Commissioners, and Section 3.09, entitled Limitations on the Terms of Office for Commission Members relating to consecutive term limits for the Mayor and Commissioners and cumulative lifetime term limits on the City Commission, providing for notice of an advertisement of the referendum election to be published in accordance with law, providing that this ordinance, when adopted, shall be submitted to the qualified electors of the City of Coral Springs at the November 2024 general election municipal ballot and shall become effective as provided for by law, providing for conflicts, providing for severability, providing for an effective date. This is a request to hold a public hearing, approve, set second hearing. There is no presentation on this, but I could walk you through the changes of or what this ordinance is. Mr. Mayor, if you'd like.
You can highlight the changes for us, Andrew. That would be great.
Sure. So this is actually was directed by the City Commission at the March workshop to draft an ordinance related to term limits, cumulative lifetime term limits, as well as extending the term of office from mayor to from 2 to 4 years. The conversations regarding this goes all the way back to the Charter Review Committee. They discussed pretty much each and every single one of these items. And I'm going to go through the ordinance real quick so that way the public's aware of what's in here. The first thing that you're going to have in this ordinance in Section 2 is the mayor now will have a 4-year term beginning November 2026. There's also a minor change in there just to be up to what is the current practice with election of the vice mayor. In section number 3, what we do is several things. One is we create a lifetime service limit of 16 years on the city commission. This will include all years previously served by anyone that's already served on the city commission. However, the 16-year cumulative lifetime limit will not apply to any member of the commission that has served a partial term. For instance, if a person resigned and the person is running for the unexpired term, the cumulative lifetime limit, similar to how we currently have our consecutive term limits, it won't apply to that. The other thing that we did in here, and it makes it actually consistent, and this is in line with what the commission directed at our March workshop, is the office of mayor is separate from the office of commissioner, even though the mayor is still considered a commissioner. What a person could do now is they could serve 8 years as a commissioner and then serve 8 years as mayor without having to take 2 years out of office. What would happen if a person wants to run for commissioner, they would still be limited to 8 consecutive years as commissioner, have to take 2 years out of office and then return for the additional 8 years. Or they could go from commissioner to mayor or mayor to commissioner without having to take that 2-year limit. So the final thing which we did in here as well is we did provide for some transition language because there might be a situation where if the mayor's term becomes 4 years, a person may only be able to serve 2 years of the 4-year term. And what this provides for expressly is that person could still run for office. They could serve those 2 years. At the end of the 2 years, automatically, the mayor or the person in that spot would be considered removed from office as a matter of law, so they get their full 16 years for the cumulative lifetime limit. And just to provide for the election of that, at the time of the year in which that automatic removal will occur, it's required to be on the November ballot. Now, as a practical matter, it'll always be in November. So if we know a person is going to be up for their cumulative lifetime service limit, but they can only serve 2 years, what'll happen is it'll happen in November. At the November election, that person will be elected. And when their cumulative lifetime service limit term limits them out, the new person that was just elected at the November election will fill their seat for the remainder of those two years. That is the sum and substance of this. This was, like I said, directed by the City Commission at the March workshop. This was discussed in depth, at least a 16-year cumulative lifetime service limit, by the Charter Review Committee. And if there's any questions, Dale's here to answer some questions, and I can answer the questions as well.
Sure. This is a public hearing. Is anyone from the public that would like to be heard? Come on up. Please give us your name and address.
My name is Logan Aliyah, and I live in 2520 Northwest 115th Avenue in the Country Club. So I just had kind of a question about what the basis for the decision was to up the term length for mayor from 2 years to 4 years. Does anybody have insight into why that might have been changed? Or that's just something I wanted to kind of ask about. I do like the changes that were made for the term limit. I think that could be good, but that was just one thing I was curious about. If maybe I could speak to somebody afterwards about that, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.
I know I'll be addressing it in my comments.
Okay, perfect.
Maybe somebody else here as well.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Mr. Marrera, did you want to be heard? I like your haircut, Joe. You're welcome.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. Joe Marrera, 3275 Northwest 114th Lane. I want to commend Ms. Dunkill for drafting the language of the ordinance. I think he captured the spirit in which the Charter Review Committee, as the vice chair, we tried to get to that point, and he certainly addressed all the points that we have not necessarily touched upon, but his ordinance really captures the intent in which we were trying to achieve, and I want to thank him for putting that together, and I hope that the ordinance gets the approval of the commission. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Marrera. Anybody else from the public like to be heard? All right, the public hearing is closed. Any questions?
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
So in response to the question that was posed, I'm a commissioner and have been for almost 10 years. I was mayor unexpectedly for 4 months. So to put it into context, if you have to be the mayor every 2 years, you are effectively running for that seat every year. And it's very stressful. I only had the job for 4 months, and it was incredibly stressful. So add running to that every year to hold that two-year seat. It wasn't fair to the person who had the job. That's why. And we run every 4 years.
Sure. Thank you, Joy.
You're welcome.
Commissioner Simmons?
Is the public hearing closed?
Or? Yes.
Okay. Yeah, and so thank you for coming up for the question. As candidly, I pushed this issue a lot. And so for me, as Commissioner Carter mentioned, you know, even with members of Congress or representatives, I don't like two-year terms because effectively you are running all the time. And I'm not saying that you're not doing a great job with that. I think you are. But, you know, when the founders originally created our government and our system of government and the offices, they didn't envision how much money would be poured into these elections, right? And so just generally, I have an issue with 2 years terms because I think you're spending more time, not you, spending more time, you know, currying favor with donors and people that can help you get reelected than spending time in your job and with the people that you represent. Secondly, currently, if you are a commissioner for 4 years, you are blessed to be reelected again for another 4 years, And then let's say, hey, you want to take a chance at running for mayor because the seat's open. Currently, you would only be able to serve in that term for 2 years. And then you would be termed out, have to take a break, and then come back. And that's currently how it's written. I think if commissioners are 4 years, mayor should be 4 years. The way the voting populace and just general citizens view mayors, they view them like you would view a New York mayor or a Chicago mayor, or just the mayor that it really, that's the first point of contact into government for a lot of people. And so they do field a lot more attention and calls and things like that. And so I think we want to have time with in that office and people being able to be good at the job and learn the job instead of, you know, you get in for 1 year and all of a sudden it's like, I got to turn around and run again. And I think that's unfair to our citizenry. So with that, I'm complete. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Oh, and the 16-year term limit, sorry. The 16-year term limit, I mean, I think that's a good, you know, we want to make sure we keep refreshing and bringing in new people and giving other folks in the city an opportunity to serve and to learn how to keep their city the way they want it to be. So thank you.
Thank you. So I have a question for you, Andrew. In the question that's going to be put on the ballot, the first part of it says the current charter provides that the mayor's term is 2 years and service as mayor counts as service for commissioner for consecutive term limits. So I think that may be a little bit confusing as opposed to counts as service on the commission.
That's something that we can look at. You know,
I would look at that between this reading and the second reading, and then if you don't mind having a discussion with me before it comes back to us. I think it could be a little bit confusing, and the confusion might lead people to vote one way, whereas without the confusion, they might vote the other.
Understood. Well,
yeah, so I'm suggesting that the question be posed more as the mayor counts as service on the commission, because a mayor is a city commissioner, but a lot of people wouldn't necessarily know that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So if people are confused, it's just easier to say no. You know what I mean?
Absolutely, and we'll take a look at that. The one thing you just need to be aware of is we only have 75 words and we're at the limit right now, so we might have to play around with it a little bit, but we'll come back with something.
Gotcha. And I can help you with that 75 word limit too. So I don't have any other questions. Dale, was there anything else you wanted to add?
Sure. I'd just like to say that I'm happy to be here tonight. Thank you for the opportunity and the privilege to be part of the leadership for the charter review process. I'm grateful that we're at this fifth and final change. And looking forward to it moving forward, and also appreciative of the fact that this was one of the most lengthy, arduous conversations we had with the committee regarding what is the right magic number for a lifetime maximum, and excited that their recommendation for a 16-year lifetime maximum is what you all are moving forward with. And as Joe had mentioned, it's definitely in the spirit and intent of what their goal was. And of course, it's even going a little step further with dealing with the term limits for the mayor, moving from 2 to 4. So thank you again. Andrew's been a great partner in all this, and I agree with what you said earlier. He did an excellent job developing this for tonight.
Great. Thank you, Dale. With that, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? So I'll just share a little bit more of why I'm voting in favor. I think to have the mayor serve a 4-year term instead of 2 serves a great purpose of stability, continuity. I've been fortunate, you know, haven't had opponents the last 2 runs, but it could certainly take away time from governing when you're having to run. So I think that 4-year term is going to be very helpful for this organization and for this community. In terms of the 16-year cumulative limit, I think that's wonderful. I think 16 years is plenty. Even when I was mayor and commissioner the first time, with that 8-year consecutive term limit, I thought it was part of my role to help educate people to come beyond the dais. And I've done so, and one of the reasons for even the Community Involved Government Committee is to, you know, educate enough of the citizens that maybe you'll want to run for office. So I really like that. And I just want to thank you and thank Andrew and everybody on the Charter Review Committee for doing the work. It took a long time. We've obviously listened to what they've had to share and come to this. And I'm happy that Commissioner Simmons pushed forward again. And you know, what's great about our team, I think we're very good listeners. And every now and then, you know, we're not perfect, but we really listen to one another and we listen to the community and to the committees that we have. And it's a great collaboration. And it's great to be a part of that. And with that, I complete my comments. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, say nay. All right, carries unanimously. Thank you, everybody. We now have the consent agenda. Are there any polls?
No.
Move consent.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 All right, carries unanimously. Next is policy formation and direction. That's number 17, memorandum of agreement for UASI.
Mayor, this is a memorandum of agreement for UASI funding, which is grant funding. Chris Swinson is going to come up and just give us a quick overview of what this is all about. We're very happy to be serving, be participating in the UASI program. It provides our public safety with needed tools and equipment.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. So I know you guys are experienced commissioners, so I won't bore you with the details. But the Urban Area Security Initiative affords the region with $14 million roughly a year, of which we get about 2.5%. Which equates to $320,000. That $320,000 affords us the opportunity to buy stuff that we normally fund through the general fund for security initiatives, including cameras, recently mobile bollards for our events to harden those events and keep us more secure, and other training programs. Recently, we were afforded an opportunity to build a training prop for the Fire Academy. It will be useful in their response and training. So this initiative was set in front of the commission for approval so that we can get our fair share of the 320 that's allotted to us and go ahead with those programs. It also is extremely beneficial in starting our real-time crime center. It also allows us to sustain programs throughout the city.
Great.
So I didn't know if you had any questions or any clarification. It actually will be followed up with 23s in a couple of months, which will be another $320,000.
Great. Any questions?
No.
All right. I'll hear a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any nays? Carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next is number 18, professional health services agreement for employee clinic.
Mayor, as Kathy makes her way up, she'll explain a little bit about this. As you know, we have an employee clinic that's very beneficial to our employees. I just want to say thank you very much to Andrew, Kathy, for all the hard work you guys put into this. I know it was a little bit of a long road, but it is the right thing to do for our operations of the clinic.
Yes.
Talk for a long time.
Long time?
Yeah, talk until Joy gets back.
Got it. So this is a request to award contract for our clinic services, our Employee Health and Wellness Center, to Medical Risk Solutions. As you may have remembered,
does
the commission...
Kathy, hang on one second.
She needs to be here.
Mayor, point of clarification, do we need to pause until we have three on the dais?
The meeting can go on, but she needs to be here for the vote.
Yeah.
She probably should pause until she comes back, since it is an item to be voted on.
Though. Okay.
That's fine. Happy to...
Like
we're
to chat about anything else.
On recess. We're going to be on recess.
Okay.
So, you have any good jokes, Kathy?
Kathy, you have to sing for us and entertain us while you.
No jokes. Okay.
No worries. We're on pause.
I will tell you a fun fact. Next week kicks off National Volunteer Week. So very appropriate for the awards tonight, but also a fun statistic is that last year our volunteers put in over 36,000 hours volunteering for the community, which equated to approximately $1.2 million in salary. So it was very impressive that our volunteers give to the community without actually getting paid.
Awesome.
There you go.
Wow, that's amazing. Thank
you. Ready?
Okay.
Okay. Good to go?
That was a great fact.
Yeah, thank you. So this is a request to award the contract to Medical Risk Solutions, who would be replacing Premise Health as the Employee Health and Wellness Center partner. As we evolve the services at the center, we felt as though Medical Risk Solutions would be a better partner for us as it relates to the service levels and the services that we'll be offering at the center for employees and family members. Just also so that you're aware, the staff that's current at the center will be offered the opportunity to move forward with the new provider.
Oh, wonderful.
Yep.
That's great.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Is there a motion to approve?
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Nope.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carries unanimously.
Thank you. And thank I did also so just want to thank Attorney Dunkiel for all his help on the agreement. We got there. Thank you.
Great. You're shining tonight, aren't you? That's great. Yeah, we really do appreciate you, Andrew. It's nice to be on the dais with you tonight. It's awesome. All right. Next is reappointments. An appointment of Alex, is it Finesh, to the Architecture Review Committee. It's a request to appoint, so we'll do that first.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Carries unanimously. And the next two are reappointments to the ARC of George Cifuentes and Richard Petrillo. It's a request to reappoint.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 Carries unanimously. And lastly, it's a request to consider the appointment of Jemsi Lamage to the representative of the residential home building industry seat of the Affordable Housing Advisory Committee. Thought he had a good video. It's mm-hmm. a request to appoint.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Carries unanimously. We are on to Commission Communications. Commissioner Carter, you go first.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I just wanted to tell our residents that there's always issues with voter fraud and things like that. So the Supervisor of Elections is going to start a new texting program, and that is going to be able to text out or in, and just so you know, so it's not a suspicious number, it's 954-357-VOTE. Congratulations to our telecommunicators who keep our 911 callers calm, and a special shout out again to Sharon Owens, who was recognized by Broward County. I was so impressed in there when I was standing in their dispatch center last night. Even though there was conversations going on, one communicator would say something and they were like, immediate response. It was fascinating. So I'm very, very proud of them and glad that we do have our own telecommunication center. Also, I wanted to honor and recognize our animal control humane officers. Thank you for taking care of our fur babies. This is Animal Officer Control Week. And we also mentioned that there's going to be the Touch a Truck at Mullins Hall, which is across from Mullins Pool. And that is for the special needs community. Come out and meet your chiefs and community officers to get a better comfort level. On the 27th, we have Earth Fest at the Sawgrass Nature Center from 9 to 12, and Coral Springs residents can get a tree or bush. I have practically planted my whole yard with this event, one per year. The resident requests that for traffic enforcement, you know, when we're dealing with people, it is always a challenge. I started my day off with somebody flipping me off because I was going 15 miles an hour in a school zone. I was like, I hope you have a bad day.
That's hard.
I couldn't believe it. And then comments about repurposing funding on agenda items. You know, prior to me running for office, I thought we were rich. I thought we had so much money. We were rolling in the dough until I read the budget and understood it. And we have a very limited amount of income. And the governor, unfortunately, or our legislators are constantly giving us unfunded mandates and taking funding away from us. Like, when I started here, we had $2 million in income in a communication services tax. I don't think it's $100,000 now. Nobody has a home phone anymore. So we do have limited resources and limited income to run our 24 square miles and our over 200 police officers and fire department, and you don't even think about it, but the roads that you drive on, all that infrastructure underground is more than 50 years old. It's got to be fixed. It's got to be planned for. So we have capital improvement programs and just plans for replacement. And the comment about cybersecurity, that is huge in trying to protect our data. We even try to trick our employees into opening things they shouldn't open just to see that they understand the risks that are involved. So yes, we do need, we have a plan. This is budget season. We're back in budget season. And it's a lot of meetings and a lot of time. But we decide how those limited resources and how those dollars will be spent to best serve the city, to maintain the public safety and make sure our roads and our parks. And I almost died when I was like, $6 million for a field for AstroTurf? But yes, this is what it takes. And then it, just maintenance and everything else. So when we set the budget and we set the plan, which we set last year's, and now we're going to go ahead and set this year's, I am grateful for the people that came forward tonight and asked for things. Because, yes, we do try to find ways and systems and processes in order to accommodate the residents. That is our goal. We are your voice. We are your representative. But I just want you to understand, we can't just change what's already been set in place. And we have the limited resources to work with. But we do care, and we do listen, and I'm sure there will be lots of discussions on how we can make things better in Coral Springs so that everybody is included. If you do need to reach me, I have office hours next Monday, 4 p.m., and you can book that through Luam at 954-344-5911. You can always email me at joycarter@coralsprings.gov.
Yes.
Thank you. I was thinking City of Coral Springs, but. And phone number, also personal phone number, 954-998-4186, or any of the social media channels at CS Commissioner 5. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Commissioner Simmons.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I echo everything Commissioner Carter said. Our budget department does a great job every year of making the budget transparent and accessible to everyone in the city of Coral Springs and even outside if people want to see. We don't have anything to hide. So everyone knows where we are putting money and why we're putting money where we're putting it. If you look at every agenda, there is a section at the bottom of every paragraph that says strategic goal. And it shows you exactly what priority or what this agenda item is attempting to achieve for the city of Coral Springs. Secondly, earlier today we heard from State Representative Dan Daly. Previously we heard from State Representative Christine Hunchowski. And then we also today heard from our state lobbyists, Candace Erickson and Lauren Jackson. What I want to impress upon the folks of Coral Springs and anyone just paying attention is that you have to understand everything that's happening at all levels of government, not just at the local level, not just at the state level, not just at the federal level. I know that we spend a lot of time focusing on the elected officials at the federal level, but really we need to pay more attention to what's happening at the state level. There's a lot that's not happening that should be happening. There are a lot of issues within Florida that we have to address, and you should pay attention to the state legislative session every year and understand what's being done in those 3 months or what's not being done in those 3 months. What items are being vetoed? Last year, there were a lot of community items that different cities put in for that were vetoed. And, you know, hopefully this year we'll see a different result. But really, you should just pay attention so you understand what's going on. There are a lot of issues that we as a city have to deal with and confront, oftentimes called unfunded mandates, where we have to implement something that will come at a cost to the city. And that goes into our budget, right? And the different things that we're trying to figure out. So please, you know, we not trying to sound like a broken record, we really want to educate you as well, so that when you come and ask us for things or ask us why something isn't happening, we don't want to just sound like we're punting the ball and saying, oh, it's, you know, this entity's, you know, issue. We want you to also understand so that we can have that conversation, and then we can work together, because we're citizens, too, of the state of Florida. So we lobby in Tallahassee. They don't care that we have commissioner on our titles. Actually, they might not even speak to us even less because of that. When they come, when the state representatives and state senators and our state lobbyists come to give us those updates, we really need to pay attention, because there's a lot of great information about what's happened, what didn't happen, what's coming down the pipeline, and 9 times out of 10, it will affect you individually as a homeowner in the city of Coral Springs. So every year when you hear about the state legislative session, please pay some kind of attention, read a few articles. Talk to your state representative, talk to your state senators, so that you know what's going on and what could potentially improve your life or harm your life or affect your life in a negative way. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You got it. Just writing a note. So the note I just wrote actually was about starting a nonprofit. And, you know, there's only so much that we can do. And as I'm listening and reading the emails, you know, the request, if we probably monetized all the requests, is, you know, got to be 7 figures, I would imagine. And, of course, you know, we can't pull that out of the hat. However, you know, we are great collaborators. We have great resources. We have great connections. And I'm sure that, you know, there'll be some things that we're able to do over time. And it's real important for those that shared with us tonight about their ideas for the special needs community to work with us, to be patient, understand everything's a process. And part of it is right now we're in budget time after we already had strategic planning. So the likelihood of somehow flipping around, you know, $200,000, in my opinion, it's not a great likelihood. But it certainly is possible that some of the programs and initiatives that Jennifer and others shared with us are possible. So I look forward to whatever staff has to share back with us over the month, 2 months, 3 months to come, whatever your timeline might be, Frank. I did visit these young men on the spectrum at Atlantis Academy. As part of the Coral Springs Commission connection earlier this week or last week, and maybe met with 11 young men in middle school, and they were wonderful. They were wonderful. They had some excellent questions, and their teacher did a great job helping formulate the questions, and they were enthusiastic and engaged, and it was really wonderful to be with them. And that's certainly something that I'd be willing to do, is visit as many of the young people that are part of the special needs population and let them know that, you know, I care about them and they're my boss. So I would love to, as you have connections with other maybe autism clusters here in the city, I would love to learn more about that, Frank. Tomorrow I'm headed to Pensacola, Friday Destin, Friday Pensacola for the Florida League of Mayors. We're having a mental health roundtable, veterans roundtable, and we're also talking about mentoring. And one of the things, too, that I thought about as we're listening to many of the speakers is how important it is to have young people be educated of what special needs look like, so that that young child that is on the spectrum isn't looked at as weird, isn't looked at as less than or different, but it's looked at as a fellow, you know, peer. And I wonder what we can do with the county, with the school board about that. And, you know, I'd certainly love that to be brought up at the Principal Advisories Committee meeting, if you'd be kind enough to do that. And, you know, just for a little bit of discussion, what some of the principals might be doing or have in mind. Let's see, one other thing. I'm complete. It's 9:05 or 9:06, so I'm complete. I'll pass it over to you, our city manager.
Thank you, Mayor. Commission does a great job at covering our events, so I won't do that again. I will say that we are having on Tuesday, April 23rd at the Coral Springs Gymnasium from 1 to 4, we're having a public safety career fair. Very popular. If you're interested in a career in public safety, it's a great place to come. Many cities come out and share their opportunities. So I would invite anybody who has a desire to be in public safety to come out and join us that day. I do want to congratulate all of the folks that were recognized today and reiterate that our staff is just amazing. Our volunteers are amazing, and that's what makes this city so great. You want to know about our events and what's going on, please visit our website, coralsprings.gov/events, and we're always here to assist our public.
Great. Thank you, Frank. Thank you. And are you taking a vacation this summer? There's no trying. Help me out, guys. Thank you. Thank you. All right, City Attorney's Office.
Just briefly, tonight we had one of our charter amendments on, and I'd be remiss if I didn't thank Dale. I'm taking my point of privilege to thank Dale for being my partner throughout the process. The other very important partner, and I hope the person on the camera can pan right next to me here so we could get her, Georgia Elliott. She was also part of our team. Thank you. There you go.
Manning's going. Very good.
But she was also part of our team. She was very integral in getting everything together, providing us information. So thank you, George. Thank you, Georgia. Thank you, Dale. And thank you to the Charter Review Committee. Thank you. Those are my comments.
Very good. For those of you that celebrate Passover, happy Passover. Have a wonderful night. See you all soon.